Man, I got back to Tulsa. It was Friday night, so we just thank God for the weather. Amen. Might get some freezing weather, I understand, by tomorrow. Amen. So we just thank God for every good and every perfect gift. Amen. All right, we just want to have a word of prayer, and we just want you to just bow your heads just for a few moments. Father, we thank you again for your glory. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you, Father, for beginning this good work within us. And you who have begun this good work shall continue to perform it. Father, we thank you today because you care for us, and we know that you touch with the feelings of our infirmities. Lord, you understand where we are. You understand the things that we are dealing with, Father, because you've been tempted. You've already been tempted just as we are tempted on a daily basis. So you know how to deliver them that are tempted. So we give you praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father, because you are for us. And because you are for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. We give you praise and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, we just thank God for the spirit of our worship, and we just want to encourage you to just worship freely. Scripture says that they that worship him must worship him in what? Spirit and in truth. And I think that we can get better at our worship just by practicing, amen, the presence of God at home. Amen. How many practice the presence of God? How many pray in the spirit at home? How many worship in spirit and in truth, sing in the spirit at home? This is the thing you want to develop, amen, and cut back on watching television. I think that would really be a blessing to us. Amen. I understand that Sister Hill knocked it out of the ballpark today. Amen. I'm very discouraged because I'm not sure I can measure up. Amen. But we thank God for Sister Hill. Listen to the message last night, and I think that the Word of God will just do, it has in it everything that's needed in order to get the job done. Mm-hmm. God sent His Word. Yes. Amen. How many know that God sends His Word? Yes. And when God sends His Word, things began to what? Change. Things began to happen. So we just want to encourage you. My motivation, I'm going to announce my topic very shortly. My motivation in this season is to get you comfortable with who you are in Christ. Yeah. This is perhaps the strongest message that we could have in terms of preparing our hearts for the things that we are planning in terms of reaching out, evangelizing, and really making a real difference this year. I just believe that this is going to be a different year. I'm committed, and Sister Hill seems to be in good shape. Amen. And two is better than one, so I believe that if we step out, Sister Hill and I believe that somebody will follow us. Amen. How many believe that?
Amen.
Amen. I just want to see families touched with the power of God. I just don't want to see all this good word and all of these messages and all of this teachings just relegated to just those that are here. I think that we need to find a way to get this word out where people haven't heard. Amen. Anybody can say amen on that. Amen. So for that reason, I've been teaching on things that will help you to build the quality of faith that's needed in order to be successful in any area of endeavor that you perhaps will choose to pursue. I mean, regardless of what your problem, your challenge, your condition, your need is, nothing significantly is going to happen in your life until you understand who you are in Christ. And we've been kind of skimming the surface in the area of God's compassion, God's mercy, and God's God being full of eager yearning, and he longs to come to our rescue. But that's the God side, and there's a what? There's our side. We have to actually come to the place where we can really get a revelation of who we are in Christ before any tangible changes will occur in terms of God working to meet our needs and to direct and to guide our lives. That's the reason why I spend much time in programming the Word of God into my spirit. It's very important. And I've been teaching for the last few weeks that the part of the Word, the area of the Scripture that really builds you in faith more than any other area, I'm going to see if you really remember that. The portion of the Scripture that builds you more than any other area is going to be the area that deals with God's disposition toward you.
Amen.
God's love and God's concern and God's fear toward you. Amen. How many believe that?
Amen.
That's going to build you more than any other area. Now, that includes God's mercy. We've been preaching about the mercy of God, all of his mercies. But the scripture says, under grace and truth, God will be more merciful. God will be more merciful. More merciful. And that motivates me to specialize and to take it a little step higher and begin to focus on God's grace.
Yes,
amen. Amen. It goes a step higher.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. God's grace. Because God's grace is focusing on what Christ did to us through his redemptive plan.
Yes.
Believe it or not, many times we might not realize this, but that's the area of the Word of God that will build your faith and that will give you boldness and confidence and will enable you to do the works of Jesus and to operate like a true believer than any other area of amen, teaching in the New Testament, God's grace. So that is the motivation behind me teaching on who we are in Christ. Amen. If everybody could master this, all of your problems will be over. Take somebody and just say, you need to listen. If you can master that. Amen. If you can master that, you are over. Oh, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. See, people that can master that, they're happy people. They're joy. See, hallelujah. Full of glory. Shandala. My scripture says, be careful for nothing. Amen. But in all things by what? Prayer. Supplication with what?
Thanksgiving.
Amen. With what? Thanksgiving. Amen. Everybody just say, with Thanksgiving.
With Thanksgiving.
Amen. That's the key. See, if you want to build the highest kind of faith, we mentioned that we have to know, amen, we have to understand the ways of our Heavenly Father. Ways. The ways, amen, his tendencies, his attitude, his disposition, what he's interested in, and the things that he do, amen. That is the ways of our Lord. And it's better to understand his ways than to understand his acts.
Amen.
Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. See, Sister Hill's acts, amen, she is basically a real... See, I know her. She's a very nice, amen, understanding, compassionate, and, you know, she don't have too many faults that I know of. Amen. We've been married for about 50 years. Our anniversary was last December, and I don't remember one or two times maybe we got in any kind of altercation. One time, I'll tell you, I'll be transparent. One time I twisted her arm. Oh, when I first got married. Took it out of the first or the last time. I pushed her up, and we've been married about a month, I guess. So my mind wasn't renewed then. Y'all can look over there and say, my mind wasn't renewed then. But amen, I didn't try to move it. So I know, basically, she is a loving, kind, understanding, and she's the type that really kind of really wants to please her husband, and I like that about her. Yesterday I came in, on Friday I came in, and she asked me before I left sharp. She said, you want me to have food ready? And I didn't think I would be hungry. I ate a hot dog before I left. I thought I would be in good shape. But when I came to talk, when I got here, I was just as hungry as I could be. I had a salad and a hot dog. That hot dog was gone. The salad was gone after about an hour. So even at 11 or 12 o'clock, she pulled out the greens. Man, and they were showing up good. And we had some chicken. I ain't gonna tell y'all what I had. Y'all make y'all hungry. But she said, man, midnight! Yes. And she said, you want this? You want that? You want me to fix this? You want me to cook you some cornbread? Midnight, Sister Deb? So I know that basically, Sister Hill, I know her heart. I know she's a good understanding, and she will definitely, amen, try to go her limit to make things pleasant. And, you know, for her family. I mean, the same way with her children. She's the same way. All right, now, but I do know that just like God is what? He's full of compassion. But there's another side of God, too. But the compassion side is what? Is the strongest side. How many can say amen?
Amen.
We can get God angry. Is that right? I can get Sister Angry. He was angry. It takes a whole lot to get her angry. It takes a whole lot to get God angry. But the Bible says he's slow to anger and of what? Great mercy. So that tells me that if I can push Sister Hill too far, although she's a loving, kind, sweet, understanding, and supportive type of spouse, that she can, what? She got another side. When I twist her arm, the other side came out. Amen. But just like God, that side is a strange work. So when God gets angry, it's not the way God normally what operates, because God is basically a God of what? Love. He wants the best for you. How many can say amen? The Bible says he's touched with the feelings of our infirmities. Let me tell you what God is concerned about. You have any idea what God is concerned about? Anybody know what God is concerned about? What his interests are. See, if you can figure out what a person's interest is, what their nature is, amen, and then you can pretty well predict, amen, what they're all about. If you understand what they do, their nature, and amen, their interest, you can pretty well, amen, determine what type of person you're dealing with. You better write that down, Brother Mariko, because you deal with a lot of folk, don't you? All right. So that's good, because God is more loving and kind. He's disposed to showing favor. You know, it was something that I have some notes I'm going to pass out. All of the teachings I've been doing for the last several weeks, I'm going to pass it out. But in this bit of material, it mentions about that knowing that God is able to do something is not a sufficient basis to build your faith to a point where your faith can actually work for you. Everybody knows that God is what? Able.
Yes,
even the devil knows. Let me ask anybody, how many know God is able?
More than
able. Amen. Anybody that don't know God is able? The Bible said even the devil believe. And they tremble.
Yes.
So believing God is able is not sufficient to get you to a point where you can really settle down in God and get established and really begin to function and operate as a believer. In other words, doing the works of Jesus. You have to go beyond knowing that God is what? Able. Amen. Now, many times people will go a step further and they will say, God is not just able, but he's willing. And sometimes people think they really got faith in it. God is willing. Yeah, God is willing. God is willing. Yeah, God is willing. Amen. Because the scripture says he's willing to do exceeding what? Abundantly above all that you can think or ask. God is willing. Everything in this word that, amen, that God has made provisions for, God is what? Willing to do. All the provisions that God has made for us, even before the foundation of the world, amen, that's the legal aspect of it. God is what? He's willing to release those blessings. Amen. The Bible says he's not short concerning his promises as men count what? Slackness. All right. But even being deep, you know, sometimes people think they live, oh yeah, God is able. God is willing. They just happy. They think they really got faith. God is willing, baby. Ooh, he's willing to take you through. But being willing is not sufficient enough to get you established where you can really believe God, amen, to receive the benefits and blessings that he has provided. Yes. So you have to go a step further to the point where God is not just able or God is not just willing to keep his word in your case, but he longs and he yearns to do that. In other words, he's full of what? Eager yearning.
Yes, amen.
In other words, he wants to save a person more than that person wants to be what? Saved. Now, if you're dealing with a person that's been seeking for the Holy Ghost, in the old school, we had people 25 or 30 years hadn't been filled with the Holy Ghost. In some churches, it's difficult to get people filled with the Holy Spirit. And in those churches, many times, the compassion aspect is not really magnified. Many times, it's the other side of God that many times people are taught that God don't want to what? He'll do it, but he's not that excited because you're so bad. Your background has what? Been so terrible. He'll do it. His grace is sufficient, but he ain't that excited about saving you because you've been such a big what? Mess. So that kind of what? That kind of gets people's expectations what? Call it the what? Wayne. They go 10 years, 20 years in a church never filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. But it's the same way with healing because many times people tolerate physical problems, sickness and disease year after year, year after year, year after year when they actually can be what? Healed. Amen. So how do you get people out of the rut and get them to a point where they get excited and their faith begins to what? Soar. Now, T.L. Osborne perhaps is one of the evangelists that have probably preached to more people in foreign fields than any other. He said that in foreign fields, he says the secret in getting people healed, let me get this straight because I want to read, all of this is in your notes, but I wanted to make sure that I had the information correct. I know what page is on page 8. There's a whole lot of pages here. He said, Brother Osborne, who has preached and ministered to the largest crowds in history in foreign fields, said that when he became bold in teaching healing and Christ's compassion, more people got saved in 1 week's time than a whole year beforehand. See, when he switched from God, you know, God's judgment, you know, and and began to focus on what? God's what? God's compassion. He says that when he began to focus and major, see, I'm learning something because it pumps me up when I'm focused on God's compassion. When I have all of these compassion scriptures and these scriptures that show God is full of eager yearning, I have all of those categorized and I have them all prepared and ready to give out, but I got to check them and go through it before I do that. And when I go through that list of scriptures that shows that God wants to do something for me and he wants to do it real bad, he gets me excited.
Yes, amen.
He gets me really, really excited. I mean, it's just like your spouse. If you know that she wants to do something for you, and you know, some spouses will do it, but they don't really want to. And say, well, I'll do it. But they're not excited about what doing it. And sometimes when I know that they're not excited about doing it, I don't have no favorable expectation. I just say, well, whatever way the ball's bounced, whatever. But when I know that they are full of glory, she's excited. When I know somebody's excited, boy, I don't back down. I just come before the throne.
Yes.
And I come what? Boldly, with a pep in my step. A sense of what? Favorable. Oh, God, I can't wait. And that's the way, but T.L. Osborne, he said, more people got saved, amen, in 1 month than got saved in a whole year. Mm-hmm. Amen. Just by magnifying, y'all listen, yes. Magnifying Christ's what? Compassion.
Yes.
Toward the sick.
Praise you, Jesus.
Oh, man. Magnify his compassion toward the sick. How many can say amen?
Amen?
And then when he began to magnify his compassion towards the sick came and got what? Healed.
Yes.
Easy.
Thank you.
No hands laid. Mass healing.
Yes.
But he said, I just focused. I just dwelled on God's what? Willingness and God's intent. He wants to heal you. And he wants, and then he began to what? Present scripture after scripture after scripture, showing them that God wanted to heal them. He's made provisions. He's willing. He's able. He's willing. But he's more than willing. He yearns. Tell somebody, said, do you know what yearn means? I didn't say earn. Yearn. That's when somebody what wants to do something and they want to do it what? Badly. Amen. How many know that makes the difference?
Amen.
Bible says that, amen, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro. He's looking. That shows me, that encourages me that God wants to what? He wants to what? He wants to help me. Amen. Psalms 138:8 it says, the Lord is touched tonight. The Lord is concerned about everything that concerns me. That makes you cry. The Lord is concerned about everything that concerns me. Amen. Praise God. That makes you feel special. Put you in a special category. That I'm loved and cared for. I have a Heavenly Father that's touched with my feelings and what I'm going through. I can cast my cares on it. Hallelujah. I can come boldly before the throne of grace to ask for mercy and to help and helped even in the time of need. Amen. So if you are praying for somebody to be filled with the Holy Spirit, you get your scriptures in line, but you magnify God wants to do it. And he wants to what, fill you more than you want to be filled. And share with them some of the scriptures, like it's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's what? Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. He wants, it's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Amen. See if that will make a difference. I remember speaking, preaching to, sharing with a, it was a, a pharmacist in Pamela. He had consulted with some of the members at this church where I was ministering, and he was seeking for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but he was confused and did not know that a person, there's a difference between the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is a gift that enables you to pray and to fellowship with the Lord in the Spirit. And he felt like that if I, everybody don't need the Holy Spirit to pray in tongues. He was against tongues because he felt like tongues were only to do special messages, which was the ministry gift of tongues. So he felt like tongues was not for everybody, not for him. But some people had that gift, but not, it was not for me. Amen. So I had to break it down to let him know that tongues, when you, the person who receives the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that's the gift that automatically comes with it to enable you to worship God. Amen. This is the worship side of the gift of the Holy Spirit. The worship side, praying in the Spirit. Put somebody and say, we need to pray in the Holy Ghost. We need to pray in the Holy Ghost. And when I remove all of the hindrances and told them that the ministry gifts of tongue is designed for people that will give out a special message, God will move on them and they will stand up and give out a message in tongues, and most times it will be interpreted by the same person or somebody else that has that gift. But God wanted everybody to receive what? The gift of the Holy Spirit with the sign of evidence of speaking in tongues. But when I made it clear to him that it was a separate experience than the talking in tongues, giving out a message, and that God wanted to fill him and wanted to fill him very badly, and he wanted to do it right then. Guess what? He received it instantly. And I've been with people that had been seeking the Holy Spirit for 30 years. I remember one guy in Port. It's difficult many times to convince people to get them at a level of faith, even for healing, unless you can share with them the area of the word that convinces them that God wants to do whatever they are expecting him to do, and he wants to do it what? Very, very badly. So I think that you would really go up to another level once you begin to meditate those scriptures and major on scriptures that pertains to God's eager yearning. God wanting to do it, and he wants to do it what? More than you actually what? Wants it done. Amen. How many can say amen? Now, I want to go up to the second level, because the second level is this. Amen. That's the way that you actually began to really understand and to know the ways of your Heavenly Father. When you really began to what? See him concerned about everything that you're concerned about. Touched with the feelings of our infant. Full of compassion, slow to anger, and of what? Great mercy.
Amen.
Amen. Now, when you begin to go further and really begin to understand who you are in Christ, that's the thing that will take you up to a different level, because you begin to move into the realm of God's what? Grace. Mm-hmm. How many can say amen?
Amen.
See, God's grace is the area of the word that convinces people that Christ has already what? Paid the price. Amen. You're already what? Healed. He was wounded for your transgressions, and he was what? Bruised for your iniquities. So that takes you. See, grace is a gift of God. It's God doing for you what you can't do for yourself. It's the sum total. See, the Bible says that when grace and truth come, it will be a greater display of God's compassion. The greatest, a greater display. It's the sum total. Everybody just repeat with me. It's the sum total.
It's the sum total.
Of all that God has done for us.
Of all that God has done for us.
Through Christ.
Through Christ.
Amen. Say it again. All right, see, when you begin to understand all of the things that God has done for us through Christ, then that's going to what? Put you into the arena of God's what? Grace. The Bible says the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by who? Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Full of grace. How many? Full of grace and truth. Amen. So if you can master the grace message, it's going to take you up even a what? Step higher. You already got a whole lot going by what? Being, amen, having a revelation of what? Christ, amen, the Lord's what? Full of eager yearning. Took somebody to say, that's pretty good. A revelation that God is what? Full of what? Eager yearning. Okay, now, turn to Isaiah, amen, 30 and 18 and 19. It shows that grace is going to take you into a dimension of God that it will enable God to do much more. Much more. Everybody just said much more.
Much more.
Amen. Because grace is the sum total of all that God has done for us through Christ. And and all that God is presently doing for us through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
See, grace is everything that God has done for us through Christ, and all that He is what presently doing for us through the power of the what? The Holy Spirit. See, under the old covenant, Christ didn't come in and indwell. So He was limited as to how much grace, how much mercy, how much love, and how much compassion He could release into your life. See, now He's in our hearts 24/7.
Yes, amen.
Amen. We don't have to go nowhere and get somebody what to pray us through.
Say that. Amen.
Amen. Christ what lives within.
Yes.
How many can say amen? Makes it a lot easier. I don't have to go to the temple. I don't have to offer up no what? No animals. Go to the priest. Let him pray. Get everything cleared out. All of my sins and everything taken care of. Amen. Every year. Through the sacrificial system. I can just what? Amen. Somebody said, I got a telephone in my bosom. I can call him up from my heart. Amen. Put me in direct contact with what? The Lord of Lords. And the what? The King. I can do my own job. I can do my own praying. I can do my own believing. Glory. Hallelujah. The Bible says that whosoever shall say to the mountain, be thou removed and don't doubt in their hearts, but believe that those things that they say shall come to pass. They shall have whatever what they say. You can decree a thing. Thou shalt decree a thing. And the thing that you decree shall be what? Established.
Amen.
See, all of this is the New Testament privilege, New Covenant privilege, glory, based on what God has done for us through Christ. Amen. He's redeemed us from the curse of the law. How many can say amen?
Amen.
He's delivered us from the power of darkness, and He has what? Translated us into the kingdom of I'm in Him, and He's what? In me. And we can work because the Bible says we are now workers together what? With Him.
Yes.
Amen. He dwells in me.
Yes.
He doeth the work.
Glory. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
I'm getting excited. Let me get myself together.
Yes, Lord.
As He is, so are we.
Yes. Amen.
Glory.
Glory. Glory. Yes, Lord.
Amen. I can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
That what? Greater is He that is what?
In me.
You're not in heaven, but in what? In me.
Yes.
So that puts it on a different, we have a different playing field altogether under grace and truth. God was good on the old covenant, wasn't He? Everybody in Egypt that came out, the 2.5 million, amen, came out with Fib and Go, that was not one what. That was pretty good testimony. David said, he healeth all of our diseases, and he forgiveth all of our what? That was under the old covenant. But now, that same God that does all of that, he's made his home on the inside of me. Christ in me, the hope of God. How many can see the playing field has been enlarged? The fountain of blessings have been what? Expanded. You have greater potential now. You can do it on a personal basis. You don't have to go through the what? High priest. Better covenant. Based on better promises. We got no problem. I don't care what we're dealing with. The revelation of who we are in Christ is the answer. Amen. When you feel like you're hooked up, tied up, joined up with Christ, when you know that you're in him and he's in you, when you know that he's for you, that's the thing that gives you boldness, because he said, fear not, neither be dismayed. I'm your God, and I'm on the inside of you. I'll help you. I'll strengthen you. I'll uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. So that God is that does all of that. Get all of the miraculous things in the Old Testament. That God is what dwelling on the inside of me. And I don't see how we could look so down and defeated on Sunday morning. My Lord, sometimes I look at some of these faces. I guess you're serving a God up in heaven only. But I want to encourage you to become God inside man. Amen. These scriptures not in here for nothing. Greater is he that is what in me. Say it. Greater is he. Sometimes the saints, brother, man, Dean, they're afraid to say who they are in Christ. And that's going to hold you back big time if you're afraid to say it. Amen. Now, the first point I want to make, people, I have to prepare her. The first point I want to make in terms of who we are in Christ is that you have to know, y'all get this, I'm going to give you a scripture. Can you flash that scripture for me? 1 Thessalonians, I believe, 2:13. You have to know that 1 Thessalonians 2:13, I believe it is. Okay, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing. Is that right? Because when we receive the word of God, which ye heard of us, you received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. That's 1 Thessalonians 2, what? 13. Okay. The first thing you need to really understand, if you really want to build the highest kind of faith, is that you have to know that the Word of God is a direct revelation from God to you. It's not to the other one only. You have to take it what? Personally. This is God's revelation. Amen. This is what God wants me to know about Him. Amen. It's God's revelation. Everybody say it's God's revelation. Amen. The things that God wants to do, amen, and he wants to do these things for you. You have to understand that the word is a direct revelation. It's just like God visiting you in your bedroom or in your living room and sitting down and talking with you personally and talking over all of your what problems, concerns, and all of the things that concerns you. God wants you to understand that his word is his message to you, and it covers every realm of your what? Of your need. So I think it would be wise for us to what? To listen. Amen. I want to just encourage you. The scripture says, take heed how you hear. I mean, you mean tell me God is speaking, you know, if Jesus came down an aisle and he spoke to us, I imagine everybody's attention would be what? On Christ. I mean, we'll be spellbound. Is that right? If Christ peered in that door, came down here and started talking, everybody would be what? Spellbound.
Yes.
Because amen, he's going to what? He's going to be speaking. Amen. His heart, the revelation, the things that he wants to do, the thing that he has provided. Amen. And it will always be concerning the things that concerns you. It's going to be about your future. It's going to be about your life. Things you're going through, the things you're dealing with, your problems. It's going to have what? The answers to the things.